Good morning. Welcome to the Brookings Institution, and welcome to all of those who are joining us now live on the webcast. We are here today to talk about the state of U.S. manufacturing and U.S. manufacturing policy. Now, this follows the President's economic address yesterday, in which he asserted the importance of manufacturing in creating a strong middle class and in generating jobs in durable industries. And the President is, in fact, in Jacksonville, Florida today, a major port region, to reinforce the case for making things in America and ensuring that the U.S. has a modern logistics and infrastructure network to get those American-made products to consumers around the world. Now, I don't want to lose sight of how far this issue has come in 4 years. Where there was once debate about whether manufacturing even mattered anymore, there's now wide acceptance of its value to innovation, to exports, to good-paying jobs. Yet the issue now seems to have hit a new roadblock, or perhaps just a speed bump. Is manufacturing's future itself durable? And how deep and wide is this, quote, manufacturing renaissance? Now, to start, there is no doubt that manufacturing jobs led the economic recovery. To date, the U.S. has gained more than 500,000 manufacturing jobs since March 2010, and further, some point to the resurgence in the automotive industry, including in Detroit. And major firms such as Caterpillar, GE, and Ford have all announced plans to shift some production operations back to the United States. And to some experts, this reshoring trend will continue as rising costs in China and cheap natural gas in the U.S. will tilt the economics in favor of America. And there is increasing excitement about new technologies in robotics, in 3D printing, in advanced materials that will accelerate U.S. leadership in design and production. And we at the Brookings Metro Program see all this forward momentum coming together in integrated efforts to boost advanced industry skills and exports in regions as diverse as Northeast Ohio, and we have Nortec here to join us on that, Louisville, Lexington, Kentucky, Charleston, South Carolina, Chattanooga, Tennessee, and Denver, Colorado. And we also see the interplay between manufacturing and services. Manufactured electronics, like phones and TVs, rely on cutting-edge services, and services firms, like a Caribou coffee chain, must order manufactured products like stools or mugs or equipment to supply every new service franchise it opens, either here or abroad. Now, with this optimism and even bullishness about manufacturing's promise, shared, by the way, by some scholars here in the institution, there is also some wariness, also shared by other scholars in the institution. Welcome to Brookings. The caution is in the thin job-creating potential of the manufacturing sector and its small size in a highly service-oriented economy that may not be sufficient enough to lift all boats. And the recent slowdown in manufacturing employment has given skeptics further fodder about the extent of the robustness of the manufacturing comeback. So to help us navigate this really important juncture for the manufacturing sector is Gene Sperling, director of the National Economic Council. We are really pleased to be hosting his new statement on this issue, which will surely add insight to this evolving debate. He will be followed by a panel of national and local leaders who have been at the forefront of manufacturing innovation. Now, Gene does not need an extensive introduction, as he has been a fixture in this town, having served 8 years for President Clinton, and now en route to do the same for President Obama. But what you may not know about Gene is that he once served as a research assistant here at Brookings, and then even prior to the Obama administration, he served as a guest scholar here, working on education issues in poor nations. And I might add, when it comes to Big Ten football, which is upon us soon, he is a huge Michigan fan. So please join me in welcoming Gene Sperling back to Brookings. Thank you.